I'm Dai Deng, a new host on Centered. My focus is how to design with emerging technologies, like artificial intelligence.
Today we're in Hyderabad to meet with the team behind Bolo, a mobile app that's helping children learn how to read anytime, anywhere, using just their voice. More than 50% of grade 5 children cannot confidently read grade 2 level text in their native tongue. So let's hear directly from the Bolo product team themselves on how they're designing for voice UI and machine learning to help solve child literacy.
Bolo is effectively a speech-based reading tutor. Reading is such a fundamental ability for you to succeed, but still worldwide, there are about 517 million children who are not functional readers even by the age they are young adolescents. If you have to learn to read, what you really need is time on task and practice and one-on-one attention. In a country like India or in many parts of the world, there are only so many schools that can be built and there are only so many teachers that can be trained. So first and foremost, it's a scale problem. Then it's also a problem of access to material. And finally, it's also a challenge of the kind of feedback you can get from your parents and from anybody around you who can help you learn to read. So really, if you have to think, how could you really bring technology to help to bear on such a big problem, that's where Bolo comes in. It uses the same voice technology and speech recognition technology that Google uses for its assistant. The additional thing that we have done over that is we have made it available offline on a device, right? So you don't need to be connected. You don't need to have internet. And it can still, in real time, hear and listen to you and give you that feedback. It's just the magic of them being heard and it being recognized what they are reading.
As we heard from Nitin, we need to ensure that applications of machine learning and voice UI are grounded in user needs. By leveraging on-device ML and its speech recognition capabilities, Bolo can provide corrective feedback at scale to children everywhere reading aloud. Can you tell us about Bolo's users?
There are two primary kinds of population that we are trying to serve in this case. The first population is definitely children who are trying to learn to read their native language or English as a second language. The second one is the parents, because these parents are the ones who are actually owning the devices.
Would you like to take us through the app?
So I just want to take you through the onboarding part. The primary purpose of having this onboarding is to let the parents be aware of what exactly the app does. The three steps that we want to take the parents through is, first of all, who is Dia? Because Dia is the central character in the app. Dia is the one who's playing the role of a person who's helping the child learn to read. The second thing that we want to do is pick which language is this child learning to read. The third thing is the parental consent, which is the most important part, because we are dealing here with children, and different governments in different areas have different rules and regulations with the data of children. Google has a perception of taking the data and all kinds of controversies. We have to be very sure that everyone understands that what kind of implications are there and the data is not being sent anywhere. The third thing is you as a parent would be giving consent to that. I am giving this device to my child and my child would be able to use it. So we take the parent in the onboarding through these three steps. So the first thing that we do is we introduce Dia and she will help their children learn to read. Now, people can select from different languages that they want their children to learn to read. So for example, if my native language is Hindi and we also have an English-only version. So every transition or every screen, new screen that you come across in the app will have some sort of audio feedback there.
Learn to read with me. Kyun na ab aap padhkar mujhe sunaye?
So this is the second step where we are actually teaching how the app would be used. And this is where we slide in the permission for that we need the mic permissions. Because if the phone is not able to listen to your voice, if we do not have the permission, the app would not be able to use.
It wouldn't be able to give you that feedback in terms of which word you read correctly or incorrectly.
Exactly.
Learn to read with me.
So you see there is a cursor movement there. Now she's asking me to read, and you see her stance change. So I'll read, learn to read with me.
जो शब्द बच्चे से ही पढ़ेंगे वो इस तरह हरे हो जाएंगे.
And she is telling that the words that the children read correct will turn green like this. So we are explaining the feedback that will be happening later on in the app as well. So this is the consent screen where we all tell the parents about what exactly is going to be the data policy or the privacy policy of the app, and none of the data that their children would use in the app would be sent to our servers. So this is the last step in the onboarding.
As we learn from Junaid walking us through the app with Dia, it's even more important that we understand user mental models when it comes to designing ML-driven experiences. We need to make sure that we onboard users by setting their expectations and that we focus on the benefit, not the technology being used.
Initially, the focus of the app was more on performance. How many words do you get right?
Okay.
Now we are moving our focus to progress.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
Right? So because children would lose the motivation to actually read the whole story. Mm-hmm. So now we are encouraging them towards progress. If they read a sentence right, if they get few words right in the sentence, we mark it as complete. We encourage him for every single word that he may get right. And the speech model really hasn't changed a lot, but how we represent it, you know, how the design looks today is very different from what it looked earlier.
As you said before, children are often afraid to get it wrong. Well, machine learning models can also get it wrong. Can you unpack for us what an example of a false positive and a false negative is in the Bolo experience?
The false positive is that sometimes they read the word incorrectly, but machine learning actually recognizes it correctly and moves on. Mm-hmm. Then there is false negative, that the child might be saying the word correct, but the speech model wouldn't really get it. Mm-hmm. We wouldn't be able to hear the child saying it right. Then the, you know, the page wouldn't move forward. Mm-hmm. The child would be stuck.
Even though they read it correctly.
Even when they read it correctly. So this was something that we found out through research as well. We spend a little time to understand that what really happens when the child gets false positive and false negative, and what impact does it have on the psychology and also on the reading experience. So here we are talking about a fact that a simple thing, that if the child is reading the word correctly and the speech model doesn't recognize it, it sort of frustrates the child. And then there are false positives when they give us those sneaky looks, when they're like, oh, you didn't get me right. But the false negative we realized was really hard on children. Earlier, our experience categorically told the child the words that they didn't get right. We would have a green and a black signal. Mm-hmm. Whenever the child would get the word right, it would show it as green. Mm-hmm. And whenever the child wouldn't get the word right, it would show as black. But sometimes we don't get the words right.
Sometimes the machine learning models don't recognize the word correctly.
Exactly. Yes. And then it remains black. Mm. And then we saw that child would get into a completionist behavior. He would want to turn all the words into green before moving on to the next page.
Oh, okay.
And they wouldn't be able to move forward. And that would frustrate the kid. So this is something unique that we found during research. And then we made some changes around that. We spoke to a few pedagogy experts. We are parents ourselves. You know, I have two young kids myself. And we started sort of emulating how we teach in real life.
Mm.
When the child is reading, we don't really tell him, oh, you got that word wrong. Why don't you read it again? Mm. Reading is important for joy of reading. And we would be a little more forgiving. So we stopped the signal of black and green. If he has read a few words correct in the sentence,
mm-hmm.
he would be able to pass through the story.
Mm-hmm.
We realized that this impacted the kids in a very positive way. We truly believe that learning is just not about pronouncing the word right. It is also about comprehension. It is also about figuring out what happened in the story, what happened to the character. It is also about evoking imagination, curiosity.
So as we heard from Ishita, machine learning models can often output errors, generating false positives and false negatives, which is why it's critical that we understand the human impact of these errors so we can address them in the UX design. The Bolo team is using voice UI and machine learning to help children not just learn how to read, but love it. By growing their confidence in reading, Bolo helps children thrive earlier on and set themselves up for even brighter futures. And as you can see, the Bolo team has designed the entire experience with children and their parents at the center of it, every step of the way. For more guidance on human-centered AI design, check out the People Plus AI Guidebook at pair.withgoogle.com.
As product creators, we have a responsibility to create things that are focused on the human experience, things that are centered.
Well, have you seen? What do you think about this line? Ah, okay.